This lecture I am going to look at nm curve derivation. So before I proceed with the nm curve derivation, let's look at asset market. The asset market are the market in which money, bond, houses and all other form of asset are traded. So in our simplified model, okay, because we are going to drag nm curve, okay, asset of wealth consists of money holding or real cash balance holding, okay, and bond holding, holding of real bond, okay. So consider a representative individual, okay, in the asset market, okay. So let's look at the wealth budget constraint of this representative individual. So given the financial wealth of this representative individual, okay, that financial wealth, okay, must be equal to real holding of money, okay, or demand for money plus his real demand for bond, okay. So let me write this thing as, okay, let me give the notation first. So I denote N, okay, as real demand for money, okay. In the Keynesian formulation, it is called liquidity preference. Because when I am driving NM curve, N is stand for liquidity preference or real money demand, okay. Generally we use the notation MD, money demand, okay. When I am writing this, this is real money demand, okay. Second thing that is demand for bond. This is real demand for bond, okay. This is nominal wealth, nominal financing wealth of this representative individual. You can write it up, nominal wealth, and P is the price level. So when I divide nominal wealth with price level, I will get the real financing wealth of this representative individual. For this representative individual, okay, his demand for real cash balance plus demand for bond, okay, must be equal to is real financial wealth. Okay, so this is budget constraint, okay, or wealth budget constraint for our representative individual, okay. And since this is a representative individual, for the economy as a whole, okay, this will represent our demand side of the wealth, okay, constraint. Then we look at the real financial wealth of the economy. So real financial wealth of the economy consist of, okay, real money supply. So money supply is given by monetary authority, it is M, okay. P is the price level. So money supply divided by price level give me real money supply, okay. Real money supply plus supply of bond, okay, must be equal to total financing wealth, or you can say real wealth in the economy, okay. So this term, okay. So I have demand side, supply side. So asset market will be in equilibrium. Let me check the recording.
Okay.
So asset market will be in equilibrium, okay, when demand is equal to supply, okay. Let's do that thing. Write up this part. So demand is this, real demand for money, okay, or money demand, real money demand, plus demand for bond must be equal to real money supply plus supply of bond, okay. Let me arrange this equation, okay. So I can write this equation in this form. I have taken on the right hand side thing, okay, left hand side, okay. So if I extend like this, this will be your left hand side and this will be your right hand side, okay. If I extend like this, this side will be my right hand side, okay. So whatever I have written here, okay, let me camerize this position. So whatever you written here, take it that side. So I can write equation in this form, okay. Now I am simplifying this, okay? Just understand, this is real money demand, I write MD. This is real money supply, don't confuse with this, this is nominal money supply. So I just write money MS, okay? So understand, this is real money supply for the time being, okay? This is demand for bond, this is supply of bond, okay? I always talk about three possibility. So the first possibility, when demand for real money, okay? Or liquidity preference, okay? Demand for money equals supply of money. Okay, this is real money demand, this is real money supply. Okay. Then, for this equality to hold, okay, what I need, demand for bond must be equal to supply of bond. Okay, if these two are equal, okay, this term will be zero. I need zero in this term, then this equality will hold, right? Because here you have zero. Demand for bond must be equal to supply of bond. Second possibility, real money demand is more than real money supply, more than real money supply. Okay, when this term is positive, say minus 2, this term must be minus 2. That means supply of bond must be greater than demand of bond. Okay, supply of bond must be greater than demand of bond. Okay, third case, money demand is less than money supply. This implies then I will be having minus 2, just for example understand, okay? And here I will be having minus 2, that means demand for bond must be greater than supply of bond, okay? So in terms of graph, how you can understand? So in order to understand this thing, okay, just look at this graph. This is demand for bond, this is quantity of bond, this is price of bond, okay? Given the demand for bond, this is the supply of bond, okay? When the supply of bond increases, price of bond will decrease, okay? When supply of bond is higher than demand for bond, we say excess demand, or this is excess supply of bond, okay? So in case of excess supply of bond, what I have? Money demand is more than money supply. Okay, look at this case. Given the supply of bond, okay, this is the initial demand of bond, this is the equilibrium price and equilibrium quantity of bond. This is represented by the first case. Okay, the demand equal to supply of bond. Okay, if there is excess demand of bond, okay, demand for bond increases, what happened? Price of bond will increase. So what happened here? Price of bond will increase. Okay, here price of bond is decreasing. So there is excess supply of bond. When there is excess demand of bond, price of bond increases. Okay. So I am going to denote this price. Okay. Excess demand for bond, excess supply of bond with the rate of interest with one table. Okay. So let me rub this thing. So this is bond with a face value of 1000, okay, and that is giving me rate of interest of 5%. So irrespective of market condition or market valuation of this bond, okay, I am getting 50 rupees as interest payment every year by holding this bond, okay. So suppose this bond is issued in 2015, market valuation is same as face valuation of the bond, so I am getting 50 rupees, so my effective rate of interest is 5%. In 2016, okay, there is increase in demand for bond, okay, then the market valuation increases. So given the supply of bond, okay, this is demand of bond. So when there is an increase in the demand for bond, this is price 1000, okay, price of bond, this is quantity of bond, okay. So when demand for bond increases, price of bond increases given the supply of bond, okay. So when I went to buy bond in 2016, okay, market valuation is 200, okay, and based on face value I will get only 50 rupees. So my effective rate of interest will be 50 divided by 200 into 100, it will be 4.1%. again, in 2017, what I see is that bond price increases to 1600. So when bond price increases to 1600, what is my effective rate of interest? 50 divided by 1600 into 100, it will be 3.1%. So based on face value, I am getting this interest payment. Okay, but I am paying this much amount. So I will calculate my rate of interest, my earning. Okay, based on what, at what price I bought that bond. Okay, so I bought that bond for 1600 rupees. So my effective rate of interest is 3.1%. So what we see is that when the bond price increases, the effective rate of interest decline. Okay. In 2018, suppose there is an increase in the supply of bond and the bond price fall, okay, to 800 rupees. So when bond price fall to 800 rupees and I buy this bond for 800 rupees, I am getting 50 rupees as interest payment based on face value. So the effective rate of interest is 6.5%, higher than the face value. Okay, 50 divided by 800 into 100, you will get 6.5%. In 2019 also, okay, what you will see that given the demand of bond, this is demand for bond, when the supply of bond increases, so this is price of bond here, this is quantity of bond here, okay, what will happen, price of bond will decline. Okay, so understanding this way will be easier. Okay, so price of bond declined to 600. If I buy a bond in 2019, okay, price is how much, market valuation is how much, 600, but based on face value I am getting 50 rupees, so the effective rate of interest that I am getting is 8.3%. Okay, so just look at these two figures. In 2016 I am paying 1200 rupees, I am getting only one bond, okay, and I am getting 50 rupees as interest payment. But in 2019, if I pay 1200 rupees, I will get two bond and I am getting 100 rupees, 50 plus 50, 100 rupees. Okay, so in that way you can see that interest earning is going to increase. So here it is 4.1 something, just add or multiply by 2, it will be 8.3. This is 4.16, so you multiply, you will get 8.3%. Okay, so this is first. During this period 2016-17, okay, price of bond increases. Okay, then means demand for bond is greater than supply of bond. When demand for bond is greater than supply of bond, okay, what will happen? Rate of interest will fall. Okay, just remember the asset market equilibrium condition that we have done. Okay, you have money demand, real money demand, difference between real money supply and money demand and money supply, and as difference between demand for bond and supply of bond must equal zero for asset market to be in equilibrium. So when my demand for bond is greater than supply of bond, okay, that means my money demand must be less than money supply for quantity to bond. Okay, if this is positive, say minus 2, this must be minus 2, right? So negative 1 will be greater than the positive 1. Okay, so here what I have, excess demand for bond. Okay, so I will be having excess supply of money also. Okay, excess demand for bond here I have. Now look at period 2018-19, price of bond decreases. Okay, that means rate of interest increases. Okay, so when price of bond is decreasing, rate of interest is increasing. Okay, here I have supply of bond greater than demand for bond. Okay, when supply of bond is greater than demand for bond, okay, what will happen, this negative term is more than the positive term. Okay, then money demand must be greater than money supply. Okay, then money asset market will be in equilibrium. Okay, so rate of interest will rise. Okay, and we will achieve the equilibrium condition that I am going to show. Okay, this process, this is what you have here. Next I am going to look at equilibrium in the money market and derivation of the NM curve. Okay, next we are going to look at equilibrium in the money market or derivation of the NM curve. Okay, and it stands for liquidity preference. Okay, in the Keynes formulation he has used liquidity preference because money has other role. Okay, it acts as a store of value. Okay, and it stands for money supply. So equality of money demand and money supply, okay, determined by equilibrium in the money market, okay. And I have just shown you that, okay, the condition that I have given, n minus n by p. This is money demand, this is money supply, plus demand for bond, supply of bond equal to zero. So asset market will be in equilibrium when this condition will hold, okay. These two sides are equal, okay. So when money market will be in equilibrium, this term must be equal to zero, then only asset market will be in equilibrium. Okay, this implies that demand for bond must be equal to supply of bond. Okay, so if money market is in equilibrium, then the bond market will also be in equilibrium. Okay, so rather than looking at the asset market, if we only look at the money market, okay, and we find equilibrium in the money market, then we can say that asset market is in equilibrium. Okay, and it stands for liquidity preference or real money demand. So equilibrium in the money market and derivation of the NM curve. Okay, so here what we are going to drive, we are going to drive knockouts of combination of rate of interest and output at which good market is in money market. So not good market, money market is in equilibrium, and it is given by NM curve. Okay, so each point on NM curve represent money market equilibrium at different rate of interest and output level. Okay, so we are going to drive this curve, demand for money. So apart from transaction purpose, people prefer to keep money because money act as a store of value. Okay, so there are three motive, okay, why people prefer to keep asset in liquid form. First motive is transaction motive. Transaction motive is associated with medium of exchange function of money, okay, and it facilitates transaction of goods and services. Okay, so every day you need money for transaction of goods and services. So transaction motive or medium of exchange function of money have in that purpose. Second is precautionary motive. So people desire money, okay, because there is some contingency requirement in order to meet some chance requirement, uneventful requirement. Okay, people keep some money with them. Okay, the point to note here is that in simplified model, okay, transaction demand for money, okay, transaction demand for money depend on income. Okay, and it does not depend on rate of interest. Okay, as income increases, transaction demand for money also increases. Okay, so when I am noting with respect to rate of interest, money transaction demand for money, okay, it is interest inelastic. It does not depend on rate of interest. It will be like this. Okay, we no need to note this. I am just talking about like this. And with respect to income, when you note this transaction demand for money, as the income increases, transaction demand for money increases. It is positive. Okay. Also, precautionary motive, okay, the money that you keep for contingency purpose, okay, depend on income. Higher the level of income, higher will be the precautionary demand for money. Okay, so we will be focusing money on transaction motive, okay, in our analysis. So we will only talk about transaction motive, and there is one more motive that we call speculative motive. Money has one more role, that it acts as a store of value. So if you have some property, that value is 5 lakh, okay, and you come to know that the price of that property is going to fall down to 3 lakh. So you can send that property and store the value of that property in the form of money. Okay, so money acts as a store of value. Okay, in our case, okay, just remember the table that I have given. In case of speculative motive, okay, what happens is that when price of bond decreases, okay, what is happening? Rate of interest is increasing. Okay, so when I am keeping money with myself, okay, The opportunity cost of keeping money with myself is the foregone rate of interest. Okay, this is what I am getting, say 8.3% in the last one. Okay, so when the price of bond decreases, okay, I will want to have less money for speculative purpose. Okay, so money demand for speculative purpose will decline. Okay, so when rate of interest increases, money demand for speculative purpose decline. Second thing, when price of bond increases, like from 1000 to 1200 or 1600, rate of interest will decline. Okay, so when rate of interest will decline, I will keep more money for speculative purpose. There will be more demand for speculative purpose. Okay, so I will keep more money with myself for speculative purpose because I will expect rate of interest to increase again to 5%. At this price, at higher price, if I buy the bond, say 1600, and rate of interest I am getting is 3.1%. So I expect the rate of interest to go up. Why? Because the face value is 1000 rupees. So I want to keep that money with myself because when rate of interest will go up, then the price of bond will decline. It will reach nearer to its face value. Then I will lose some money. So I will keep some money with myself for speculative purpose. So the amount of money that I keep with myself for speculative purpose will increase. So what we see is that there is a negative relationship between rate of interest and speculative demand for money. So how we can draw this one? Look at this. Here you have rate of interest. Here you have speculative demand for money. And this is negative news law. Higher the rate of interest. Say 8.3%, this one. No, I will need the speculative demand for money. I will keep less money with myself. I will buy more bond. No other rate of interest. Say 3.1%. This is I2. I will keep more money with myself. Because I will expect the rate of interest to go up. Because the face value is 1000 rupees. So I will get at least 5%. Here this is 3.1%. So this is what you have. So here you are getting negative relationship. And with respect to income, my speculative demand for money is not getting influenced. But the position of this speculative demand for money, depend on your income level. Look at this. So money demand, you are doing for three purpose, two purpose I connect together. So one is transaction demand for money. Second is speculative demand for money. So I will know my transaction demand for money. Only when I will know my income level. So given the income level, say Y1, I will know my transaction demand for money. Rest of the money will be for speculative demand purpose. So what position I will have for this speculative demand for money will depend on my income level. Keep this thing in mind. Let me take photo. So the equation for demand for money can be written as, I am using the Donbos formulation. Let me check the code. Equation for demand of money. So I depend money demand, real money demand on liquidity coefficient by N equal KY minus HI. So what is K? Just look at this thing. Here you have positive sign because you have nothing there. So K is the responsiveness in money demand due to change in income. And this is associated with your transaction demand for money. Responsiveness in money demand. Due to change in income. How much will be the responsiveness given by K? Higher the value of K, higher will be the responsiveness in money demand due to change in income. Lower the value of K, lower will be the responsiveness in money demand due to change in income. Second thing, let me write here. change in money demand due to change in rate of interest is minus H. Okay, so this is responsiveness in money demand due to change in rate of interest is given by H. Okay, and this is my speculative demand for money. Okay, now I have to draw my NM curve. Okay, so NM curve shows the relationship between rate of interest and output level. Okay, so before I draw NM curve and after specifying this demand for money equation, okay, let me look at supply of money equation. Okay, so money supply, this is nominal money supply. Okay, it's given by monetary authority, say M. Okay, and P is the price level. P is the price level. So real money supply will be M by P. Okay, in equilibrium money demand must be equal to real money supply. This is real money demand, this is real money supply. Okay, let me take purpose. Okay, I love this part. Okay, so money demand must be equal to real money supply. So this is going to be K by minus HI, okay, equal M by P. I have on this part. So I am drawing my NM curve with respect to rate of interest, okay, and the locus of combination of rate of interest and output at which good market is money market is in equilibrium. Okay, good market we have done in the IS curve. Okay, so I will write this equation in the form of I. Okay, so after manipulation you can get I equal K Y minus M by P 1 over H. Okay, so this is NM equation. Okay, now before I proceed further, okay, since real money supply is given by monetary authority, so how the graph will look like and how the demand for money graph look like, okay, let's look at that two possibility. Okay, here I am going to draw demand for money graph. Here you have rate of interest, here you have money demand. Okay, so your money demand schedule is given by N equal K Y minus HI, and I am drawing with respect to rate of interest. Okay, this is your money demand, and the change in N over change in I equal minus H. Okay, so now will be negative. Okay, my demand curve will be negative slope. Okay, so I want to draw graph for this equation, and this is linear equation. Okay, you can see it. So this is my money demand curve, negative slope. Okay, and where I have only two variables, output and rate of interest. So when there is a change in rate of interest, there will be movement along the curve. Okay, and when there is change in income level, for different income level I will be having different money demand. Okay, so this is money demand based on income level, say Y1. Okay, so when there is a change in rate of interest, so this I1 is rate of interest, so my money demand will be this much. Okay, when rate of interest decreases, money demand will increase. Okay, why money demand will increase? Because when rate of interest decreases, people want to keep more money with themselves for speculative purpose. Okay, so money demand will increase. Okay, next, when this money demand curve will shift rightward on that part. Okay, so I told you people already that money demanded for transaction purpose and speculative purpose. Okay, and this is based on a given income level y1. Okay, for given income level, say y1 is say 10,000. Okay, so your money income, how much money you demanded for transaction purpose, say 4,000, and speculative purpose you demanded 6,000. Okay, so when income level changes to y2, say 20,000. Okay, the demand for money will also change for transaction purpose. Because when output increases, okay, so you will demand more money for transaction purpose to facilitate transaction of that good and services. Since I double the income or output, okay, transaction demand for money will also double. Speculative demand for money will also double. Okay, so for the given rate of interest, say I know, okay, demand of money will increase. Before it is this much, now it is this much. Why demand for money increase? Because your income has increased from y1 to y2. Okay, so your money demand curve for the given rate of interest means shift rightward. This is k y2 minus hi. Okay, since I am drawing with respect to rate of interest, when they change in other variable, demand curve will shift rightward. That means when your income increases, demand for money curve shift rightward. Okay. Now, supply of money is exogenously given, okay, by monetary authority. So it is independent of these two variables, rate of interest and your income level. Okay. So it is given by monetary authority M by P. Whatever be your rate of interest, money supply is given. Okay. Whatever be your rate of interest, money supply will not get influenced. In equilibrium, money demand must be equal to money supply. So I put this graph together. In the vertical axis, you have rate of interest. In the horizontal axis, I will put money demand and money supply together. Okay. So I have to put this curve here, or both this curve I can put here. Okay. Whatever I can do that. Okay. Okay. So let's look at money market equilibrium condition. Okay. Let me draw this graph. So here your rate of interest, okay, I'm writing money demand and money supply here. So this is money supply given by the monetary authority M by P, real money supply. And suppose income level is y1, okay, this is your money demand. Okay, let me write the equation here, n equal k y minus h i. Okay, so when my income is y1, okay, my money demand will be represented by this equation n1. Okay, you can say k y1 minus h i. Okay, so I will get rate of interest i1. Okay, so net plot this in another graph in I by axis or I by plane. Okay, so when income level is y1, okay, my money demand schedule is represented by this black line. Okay, given the money supply, I get my rate of interest to be I1. So I combine this rate of interest with this income level, I will get first point of, or first locus of point of my NM curve. Okay, so I get first point of my NM curve. Okay, suppose income level increases from y1 to y2, okay, then for the given rate of interest, okay, what will happen? Demand for money will increase. Okay, when income increases, for the given rate of interest, demand for money increases from n1 to n2. Okay, so my demand for money will be k y2 minus h i. Okay, for the given rate of interest, look at this point. What we have here, money supply is here, money demand is more. At this point, money demand is greater than money supply, right? Remember asset market equilibrium, n minus m by p plus demand for bond minus supply of bond equal to zero. Okay, when money demand is greater than money supply, okay, what we have? supply of bond is greater than demand of bond, then we have excess supply of bond, right? So at this point, I have excess demand of money or excess supply of bond. Okay. Now, remember the table that we have done. When we have supply of bond greater than demand of bond, what will happen? Rate of interest will increase. Okay. So rate of interest will increase and new equilibrium will be achieved here at higher rate of interest, I2. Okay. So when income level is Y2, okay, money market will be in equilibrium at higher rate of interest, I2. So I am combining I2 and Y2 to get second locus of point or second combination of points for my NM curve. Okay. So this is I2 and income level is Y2. So this is second point that I get. I join this locus of combination of point to get my NM curve. Okay. On this point on the NM curve are equally feasible. Okay. So when rate of interest is lower, okay, it must be corresponding with no output, okay, to have equilibrium in money market. When rate of interest is higher, output must be higher, okay, then money we have equilibrium in the money market. Okay. Now look at this point. Look at this point. Okay. When rate of interest is I2, money demand is here, given by money demand curve, and money supply is this much. Okay. So at this point, money demand is less than money supply. Okay. So I have excess supply of money. Okay. Look at this equation. When money demand is less than money supply, okay, then I need to have demand for bond must be greater than supply of bond. That means excess demand of bond. Okay. So here I will be having excess demand for bond. Okay. And the reason is clear, right? Because rate of interest is higher. Okay. People want to hold more bond and they want to keep less cash with themselves. Here they have excess supply of bond. Okay. People don't want to hold bond at when there is excess supply of bond. Okay. Because they expect rate of interest to increase. Okay. So here you have this equilibrium. So let me look at these two points. So this is a point E1, this is E2, this is E3, and this is E4. Okay. So this is E1, this is E2, this is point E3. So on the right of NM curve, okay, money demand is greater than money supply. You have excess demand of money or excess supply of bond. Okay. And look at this point corresponding to E4. Okay. You have excess supply of money. Okay. Or excess demand of bond. At E2, E1, okay, what you have? Demand for money is equal to supply of money. So you have equilibrium in money market. So automatically you will be having equilibrium in bond market also. Okay. So NM curve represents locus of combination of rate of interest and output at which good market is in equilibrium. Okay. Let me take photo. Next, we are going to look at shift in NM curve, okay, and whether even in under what condition NM curve will be steeper or flatter. Okay. One thing that we should know that this NM curve I have drawn based on a particular real money supply. Okay. So for the given money supply, okay, I have drawn this NM curve. So when there is a change in real money supply, okay, we will see that there will be a shift in NM curve. Okay. So let me rub this thing and then we will look at that possibility. Okay. So I repeat again, for the given money supply, okay, I will have a particular NM curve. Okay. When money market, real money supply will change, I will have a different NM curve. Okay. So next I am going to look at shift in NM curve. Shift in NM curve. Okay. Janet, look at this possibility. So here I have debt of interest. Here I have money demand and money supply. Okay. This is a real money supply M by P1. Okay. So real money supply is M by P. How my real money supply been increased? Okay. So this is my nominal money supply. Okay. First possibility is that this nominal money supply MS, okay, increases. So this M been increased, real money supply been increased. First possibility. Second, when there is a change in price level, that means price level decreases. Okay. That means when denominator decreases, my real money supply decreases. Or it can be a combination of both. Okay. So when there is a change in my nominal money supply, or when there is a change in price level, okay, that means when price level decreases or money supply increases, my real money supply increases, M by P will increase. Okay. So I'm looking at the possibility where real money supply increases. Okay, you can look at a possibility where real money supply decreases also. Suppose my real money supply increases from this M by P1 to M by P2. Okay. Let me draw first demand for money segment. Okay. I am drawing only one demand for money segment. KY1 minus HI. Okay. And here I am drawing my NM curve. Here I have rate of interest, here I have output. Since I have drive, I am drawing only one money demand segment. This is my equilibrium rate of interest. And my output is Y1. Output is Y1. Okay. So I will get, I need to have 2 points, but by having 1 point also, I can draw this thing. But when they ask you to drag, make 2 points, okay? At least 2 points, so that you can join the 2 points and drag your NM curve. So this NM curve is based on my money supply MP1, okay? M by P1. Okay? Now suppose there is an increasing real money supply, okay? It can increase either because nominal money supply increases or price level has decreased, okay? So my new money supply is this M by P2. Okay, so there is excess supply of money. Okay, at the given rate of interest, there is excess supply of money. Okay, so in order for people to hold money more, okay, rate of interest must reduce. Okay, what we have here, we have excess at this rate of interest, we have excess supply of money. Okay. This is the demand of money at this rate of interest. Now the supply of money increases. So when I want people to hold more money, rate of interest must be decreased and must be this much. Then money market will be in equilibrium. Okay. So when rate of interest decreases, people want to keep more money with themselves. Okay. So when rate of interest decreases, income level is same. The rate of interest is I2. And income level is same by 1. Okay. So I will get a new NM curve. This NM curve is based on money supply M by P2. Okay. So when real money supply increases, okay, given the income level, there is excess supply of money. Okay. So in order for people to hold more money, rate of interest must decrease. Okay. So we will be having money market equilibrium. Okay. With same output level and lower rate of interest. Okay, so this is how NM curve sit. Next, we are going to look at slope of NM curve. Okay, let me take photo. If you remember equation that we have derived for NM curve, okay, so I have written, let me derive it again, KY minus HI equal M by P, okay, so this I have written as I equal KY minus M by P 1 over H, okay, so this I need to drive equation, because I am drawing NM cap in the I y axis. So change in interest rate due to change in output is K by H. Okay, so K by H give me slope of NM curve. Okay, so this is positive. Okay, so slope of NM curve will be positive. Okay, now in the denominator I have K. If you remember this thing, K y minus H I. Okay, so K is responsiveness in money demand due to change in income. Okay, so higher the value of K, steeper will be my NM curve. Okay, there is a direct relationship. So my NM segment, this is the equation of NM curve. NM curve equation. Okay, so higher the value of K, okay, this is slope of NM curve. Okay, my NM curve will be steeper. Okay, it will be like this. And no other value of K, responsiveness in responsiveness in money demand due to change in income. Okay, if this is lower, my NM curve will be finite. Okay, it will be like this. So this is first case we have. Second thing, slope also depend on your H. Okay, responsiveness in money demand due to change in rate of interest. Okay, this inversely related. Slope of NM curve is inversely related with H. Okay, so let's look at the possibility. So suppose H equal 0, first case. Okay, so when H equal 0, look at this equation, the money demand equation, K y minus H I. Okay, this term is 0. Okay, so your money demand is money for transaction purpose, right? So it is interest inelastic. I am drawing this aspect to rate of interest. So you know it is infinity, right? So I don't need to worry about it. When H equal to 0, okay, anything over 0, generally we say that it is infinity, okay? So you will be having like this. Okay, your NM curve will be like this. Okay, and in the classical case, okay, the only purpose of money is for transaction. Okay, this case represent my classical case. Okay, when NM curve is vertical, then I will be having classical case. Okay, next, for any given value of any given value of K, okay, if S tend to infinity, okay, then slope will be 0. Okay, slope will be 0. This will be my NM curve. Okay, I am repeating again. For any given value of K, okay, if responsiveness in money demand due to change in rate of interest is very high, okay, then my NM curve will be horizontal. Okay, and this case represents my Keynesian case. Okay, so this is second possibility. Third possibility that we have done, okay, that H lies between 0 and 1, lies between 0, not 1, and infinity, okay, because we are looking at infinity aspect. Okay, so in that case, okay, when it tends to 0, okay, because your demand for money is ky minus hi. Okay, when it tends to zero, then it will be behaving like this. Okay, NM curve. Okay, and when it tends to infinity, it will be quite finite like this. Okay, this is NM curve. And the general possibility that we have taken, okay, is that your NM curve is positive notion of, that means lies between 0 and 1. This is NM curve. Okay, so this is the slope of NM curve, and it is given by ratio k by h. Okay, so this and our topic of NM curve. Okay.